Hello, this module is on the stuff of genes, DNA as the genetic material. So first, let's recall Griffith's discovery of bacterial transformation in the 1920s. You may recall that Griffith was actually looking for a way to produce a vaccine against the pneumonia that killed off many people during the influenza epidemic of 1918. So he was actually studying not influenza, which is of course a virus, but the Streptococcus pneumonia bacterium that killed people during that epidemic. So here we have the wild type strain of Streptococcus pneumonia called the S strain. The S refers to the smooth appearance of colonies on agar plates. And when these bacteria were injected into a mouse, the mouse would die within a day or so. There was a mutant strain called the R strain of S pneumonia. The R stands for rough because the colonies that were produced would have a rough appearance. When these were injected into the mouse survived. What Griffith attempted to do was to produce a vaccine by immunizing mice. And the first thing he did was to inject the S strain after it had been heated to kill the actual bacteria. And sure enough, the mouse survived the injection and was quite alive and healthy after 24 hours. If that mouse were reinjected with living wild-type S strain bacteria, they died in a day. So in fact, no immunity was achieved. The R strain and the heat-killed S strain were injected together. Griffith reasoned that perhaps something from the R strain would combine with something from the heat-killed virulent strain to perhaps confer immunity. Surprisingly, though either alone, the R strain or the heat-killed S strain, didn't affect the mice, when he injected both together, the mouse died within a day or so. And what's more, the blood of the dead mouse contained nothing more than living S strain. In other words, you could take the blood of the dead mouse, plate it on an agar plate, and grow smooth colony virulent cells. And you knew they were virulent because you could re-inject such bacteria into a fresh mouse and the mouse would die in a day. What Griffith concluded was that the rough living strain of the cell was being transformed somehow, genetically transformed, by something from the heat-killed S strain. Avery, MacLeod, and McCarty actually identified what came to be called the transforming principle, that molecule which causes the genetic transformation. So what they did was they purified DNA from virulent cells, mixed them in a tube with non-virulent R cells, waited for a time, and then took the resulting cells and injected them into a mouse, and lo and behold, the mouse died. From which you might conclude that DNA from virulent cells was the transforming principle. In fact, you could take cells out of that dead mouse and grow them on agar, as I indicated before. The convincing thing, of course, was that when they purified either protein or lipids or RNA or carbohydrates separately from the heat-killed S cell mixture and tried to do the same experiment, adding those in turn to non-virulent R cells, they had no effect. The mouse then would survive a subsequent injection. So Avery and company concluded that the DNA from the S cells was the transforming principle. DNA for many years was thought to be a very simple molecule. At the turn of the 20th century, when it had first been discovered chemically, it was known that it was composed of the four different nucleotides, but at first people thought that it was in fact just a tetranucleotide, you know, AGCT or ACGT. There were 256 combinations of A, G, C, and T that one could create in terms of the order of the bases. But it would be hard to explain all the genetic differences within an organism, never mind across organisms, by just 256 different sequences of bases in DNA. Over the next several decades, it became clear that DNA was not just a tetramer, but was in fact quite a long or quite a large macromolecule. Nevertheless, it was difficult to conceive of even a large molecule consisting of just four individual monomers, A, C, G, and T, bases. It was hard to conceive of that as encoding the necessary genetic information to make a whole cell or a whole individual. So for many years, people thought it must be proteins that contain genetic information. Now, proteins must be the stuff of genes. Why? Because proteins were made up of 20 amino acids, and it had become clear in the 20s, 30s, and 40s that different proteins can have very, very different combinations of those 20 amino acids. So structurally, proteins could be much more diverse, and we've already seen that they, in fact, are quite diverse. So there was a bias that proteins were the genes, not DNA. People thought perhaps the DNA was a kind of skeletal framework in the nucleus on which the genes would be hung. That was the idea. Well, let's talk about viruses. You may, we're headed towards the Martha Chase and Alfred Hershey experiment using phage or bacterial viruses. So let's say a word or two about them and remind you that viruses, of course, are not alive. They only reproduce when they infect a cell, and they pass their genetic information on by replicating their DNA. But the virus itself is not a cell, and it's not alive. So there was a hypothesis around that since bacterial viruses contained proteins and DNA, that one of those two would be the genetic material, either proteins or DNA, and that whatever the genetic material of the virus was, that would be the genetic material of all cells. Let me remind you, or tell you if you haven't seen this before, about the life cycle of a bacterial virus called bacteriophage, or phage for short. Here's a picture of one off to the left. The DNA is the red stuff inside a protein coat, and that's a typical bacterial virus. They often have this nice geometric structure on the outside. The frizzy things coming off the what looks like an octagon here, those are actually going to recognize a cell and allow the virus to infect the cell. The cell itself has little receptors which allow that recognition. Here's the contact. The infection is established when the cells start to produce more viruses, or the viruses actually take over the cell and reproduce themselves until they increase to such numbers that they burst open the cell. That's a process called lysis. And all the new bacteriophage or phage are released, and they go on and infect neighboring bacterial cells. It was known at the time that Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase began their experiments that proteins contain sulfur but don't contain any phosphorus, while DNA contains phosphorus but no sulfur. This made it possible, along with the availability of radioactive sulfur and phosphorus, to test which component of the phage, the DNA or the protein, was the genetic material. So what Hershey and Chase then did was to infect E. coli cells with a particular kind of phage and allow growth in either the presence of radioactive, that is P32 phosphates, or S35 sulfates. And the result was then, of course, to make radioactive phage, radioactive virus particles. Eventually, in a culture like this, all of the cells would die, and you would be left with nothing but new, quite infective phage. But in this case, they would either contain radioactive P32 labeled DNA, or they would contain radioactive S35 labeled coat proteins. So here's what they did. In one case, they took the radioactively labeled, this is bacteriophage T2, by the way, bacteriophage in which the DNA was labeled with P32, and they added that to fresh E. coli cells. They waited a short time until infection took place, that is, until the viruses attached themselves to the bacteria, and sufficient time had elapsed so that there was an actual infection. And then they put this stuff in a high-speed blender, much like your mom or dad might have had in the kitchen to blend fruit juices and the like. The blender, by the way, was actually invented not for the kitchen, but for this kind of biological experiment. The blending tore the viruses off of the surface of the E. coli cells, and it made it possible then to put that mixture into a centrifuge and actually separate the viral particles from the bacterial cells. Bacteria, being much larger and more massive, pelleted at the bottom of the cell, whereas the small viral particles remained suspended in the supernatant. It was possible to look in the electron microscope and actually see viral particles and bacteria that had become separated. The radioactivity from this experiment was largely in the pellet, which means the DNA that was radioactive in the original P32 labeled T2 bacteriophage seemed to have gotten into the bacterial cell and therefore traveled to the pellet at the end of the experiment. These cells, by the way, if some of them were put aside and allowed to continue life in the test tube, and they eventually lysed. There was indeed an infection. The other experiment, of course, was to take the sulfur 35 labeled bacteriophage. In this case, it was the protein coat that was radioactive, so I've shown that here as a red protein coat. And the experiment was identically repeated, that is, after time for infection, the mixture was put in the blender, the phage coats separated from the cells, and this time, after centrifugation to separate the viral particles from the bacterial cells, it was the supernatant that was radioactive, meaning only the proteins were radioactive, and therefore only the phage were radioactive. These bacterial cells were able to go on in lice. So the infection had been demonstrated, and the radioactivity in this case was associated with the protein. So there it says, infected cells from both cultures would eventually lice, proving that infection had actually taken place. And so the conclusion to Martha Chase and Alfred Hershey's experiment is, it is the DNA of the phage that contains the viral genes which allow this virus to replicate itself and eventually cause bacterial cell lysis. So with this experiment in the late 40s, it was clear that the genetic material was DNA. At least it was clear to most people. There were issues, however. DNA structurally was still a very simple molecule. It might have been a macromolecule, but it was very simple. It was only composed of four bases. So how could such a simple molecule actually contain a blueprint for cells or a blueprint for life? And so it became important to understand what a DNA molecule actually looked like, and that began in the race. To determine the structure, no. To determine the structure of DNA.
And that brings us to the end of this presentation.